Well, hello, 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 and welcome once again to 25 O'Clock. I'm your host, Dan Drago. Thanks for being here. Thanks for joining me on the show. Philadelphia's longest-running music podcast, I think. On the show this week, this is a first for me. Not a first of having two guests. We've got Marcelyn and Juliet Eve from the band Bad Sleeper on together. That's not new. We've done things like that before here. But this is the first time I've ever done two people virtually, which you would think would be easier, and it was. And also, it was just interesting. Now there were like two heads staring at me through the screen instead of the typical one. But it was a great time. It's a great talk. They've got new music coming out that they collaborated on together. We'll talk about Marcelyn and Juliet more in just a sec. But as always, if you're new to the show, old to the show, medium to the show, I highly, highly recommend that you check out 25oclockpod.com. That's our website out there. You can get everything there. All the episodes are available for streaming and for downloading. Sign up for the mailing list. Find us on Facebook and Instagram and Twitter. Check out the Friends and Neighbors page. It's where I link anyone and everyone who's ever been on the show. So if you hear someone you like and you want more information, go to that Friends and Neighbors page. Click. Just click a lot. I didn't take a breath at all and all of that. And then in the end, it just sort of culminated in like having to breathe. I don't know why I'm telling you this. But 25oclockpod.com. Do all the things there. Remember to breathe at 25oclockpod.com. That should be the tagline. Every time I come up with a new clever tagline, I think it's like the most creative one I've ever come up with. But that's good. 25oclockpod.com. Remember to breathe. Let's talk about Marcelyn and Juliet. Marcelyn was back on the show last year, I believe it was. Yeah, around the time that her record, Is This Women's Lib, came out. It's a great record. You should go back and find that episode. And Juliet fronts the band Bad Sleeper, a very cool kind of proggy heavy rock band. You can find music by Bad Sleeper at badsleeper.bandcamp.com. And, of course, find Marcelyn's music at marcelyn.bandcamp.com. That's M-A-R-C-E-L-Y-N, Marcelyn. Why are they on together? Well, they collaborated on a song together, and in the way that it came out, they didn't just like make a big super band and make one recording of a song. They wrote a song together, and then Marcelyn the band, which is what they're called, Marcelyn the band, when she has a band with her, went and recorded their version, and Juliet and Bad Sleeper went and recorded another version, but it's the same song. It's called Empty Room. You can get it at both the band's band camps, as I just said, and you can find it on all the streaming platforms and anywhere you buy music. The track's called Empty Room, and it's very, very cool to hear two different bands kind of put their takes out on the same sort of source material. And of course, to make it more interesting, none of them could really get together because they wrote it, and when they were getting around to finally getting ready to work on it together, the pandemic happened and people really couldn't get together anymore and bands really couldn't rehearse together anymore, much less record together anymore. So that was interesting too. They talk all about this. It is a really, really fun chat. So why don't we get into it? Why don't we get into my conversation with Marcelyn and Juliet Eve from Marcelyn the Band and Bad Sleeper, respectively. We talk about their song Empty Room and a whole lot of other things. So let's get to it here on 25 O'Clock. You guys made a release without ever having anyone have been in the room together at all.
Well, Juliet and I were in the room together for the writing process right before everything hit, but yeah, we recorded remotely, did all of it in our rooms.
Yeah, or that's living rooms, depending, but yeah. Yeah.
We're all just a bunch of creators in our little rooms. Now.
Yeah.
That's all we are.
I'm in a parent's spare bedroom that I've converted into an office. It's very chic.
Oh, nice.
It's not at all.
It's not.
Now thinking back on it, I think like one of the times that Marcelyn and I ever got together, we were getting kicked out of one of Penn's practice rooms because mm-hmm. it was around the time that the pandemic started in the United States. So it was like actually pretty.
It was like early March.
Yeah, I was like, I remember that now. And we were like, oh, no, what are we going to do?
I think it was, like, the Friday that, like, everything got canceled, at least at Temple. It was, like, that day. It was the end.
So you guys had known each other a bit before then, though, right?
For about a year-ish. I don't think I only think I saw Marcelyn once at a show that we played together, our bands played together, but it was all kind of virtual friendship beforehand.
Yeah, we had talked about starting a band, and then I started working and we got too busy. But we connected through the DIY collaborative page, like everybody else in Philly.
I was about to ask on that when you had said, like, you guys had first gotten together on a Facebook page. My first thought was just like, I'll bet any amount of money right now that it was the Philly DIY community page bringing us all together.
Yeah.
I did want to talk about that a little bit, though, sort of the importance of like these virtual spaces and like online message boards and social media being kind of like the lifeblood of DIY.
Yeah, for sure. I've often thought about getting off of Facebook just because, you know, social media is a weird, weird thing, but it would really be such a loss to me to not have access to the DIY groups. There's a couple cool ones that I'm in for queer people and all women and non-binary people. Mm-hmm. So I've made a lot of connections just through Facebook groups. It's that easy.
Yeah, and I agree, it's like a really good place to start too, because, like, you know, you move to Philly, you're brand new and you're like, what do I do? And, you know, it's really, I think it's a good place to start. And once you start meeting people online, you go to their shows and then it just branches out immensely from there. And you know, it can stay online, but it's like pretty awesome how it like translates in person.
Yeah, yeah. And especially because like that sort of communication amongst people, it's not regulated really by like time or access or anything like that. You can just talk to each other. You're not on anyone's clock, and you can do it from home too. You don't have to like go out like to every open mic to like make sure that you meet all the people. So you can decide which of the people are the people that you want to work with.
That's true. I think now we also, I don't know if it's just me, but I feel like you can kind of get a personality from the internet version of people too sometimes now. Like there's like all these emojis and all these like things. So yeah. I don't know. It's you and who like responds when you ask them a question, who doesn't, you know, it's like it's kind of, it's interesting. It's a new psychology.
No, yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah, it's like we're becoming more fluent in how to get our message across online too. I was thinking about this the other day. It's funny that came up. Yeah, it's really interesting.
No, speaking to your point, Julia, that's absolutely accurate right there. That like you can already tell. It's like, well, look, if you can't return a message or at least some bit of correspondence, and like, are you going to show up to band practice? Are you going to show up to like, you know,
a gig?
Yeah, a gig. The thing we said we were going to do. It's something that, at least for me, as I got older, and I realized more and more that it was so very important to do the thing that you said you were going to do.
Yeah, follow through is huge.
Mm-hmm. Yep, because I think a lot of people get into being creative and making music and stuff like that, not really understanding everything that goes into it. And then when you start to like butt up against like the more difficult things or the more like rote and mundane things, there's certain people who are just like, nah, I don't want to do that. I'm just like, well, you kind of have. If you want to be any good at this, you kind of have to.
Yeah.
Now, I had Marcelyn on before, so I've gotten the whole story of Marcelyn, where she came from, and all that. But Julia, I don't know anything about you, other than you come with Marcelyn's seal of approval. So like that,
yeah. I'm honored.
It's the DIY. It's the DIY stamp of approval. Like, because I typically do this with people who are on the show just solo, to get a little bit of like where you're from and like how you got into music and things like that. So where are you from originally?
I am actually from the Hudson Valley, New York. I grew up there, and then I went to school in Manhattan at Fordham for undergrad. I commuted from home to the city, and then I got a job outside of undergrad at Penn. I do molecular neuroscience research. So it was kind of, music has always been a part of my life. I think I started when I was like 5 or 6, just singing in like the school choirs, things like that. And honestly, it's been a fun transformation going from like these classical choirs. I also played clarinet in like classical orchestras and bands all throughout like, you know, elementary, high school, middle school. And then I got to Philly, I moved there, and I don't know, I felt like I was kind of restricted almost by like sheet music. And I felt almost like I was like ready. I had had all these poems in my notebooks, and I was just like ready to kind of like try to do something new. It was like a fresh start when I moved here. And I coincidentally had these art student roommates, and they were like, hey, you should check out this DIY Philly page. And that's kind of where it all began for me. So I've really only even been writing music the past year and a half or two years. So it's been awesome. I have received like nothing but support and like acceptance from the community.
Yeah. Which part of Hudson Valley are you from?
Orange County.
Okay. I'm from Western New York originally, but I know down around there a lot. So Orange County, we're talking like Middletown type of
You nailed it. Yeah. I'm from Monroe, New York, but Middletown's like
Monroe. Okay. Yeah. I got good friends who live in Otisville.
Nice. Yeah.
Yep. It's interesting part of the world down there in Orange County. It's like, it's a lot more rural than people think that it is.
Yeah. It's like it weaves in between like ruralness and then just like miles of gas stations.
Yes. It at times feels like Northern Jersey. I swear if you blindfolded me and dropped me in one or the other, I wouldn't necessarily be able to tell you immediately where I was.
Yeah.
I do want to touch on the molecular biology thing, because that's something I don't know anything about.
Yeah, I mean, you probably actually know more about it than you think you do. It's you, you know, but
sure.
I actually, when I was in high school, I thought I was going to go into clarinet performance. I was like a sophomore in college, and I was like, yeah, I love this, like getting all the solos feels great. Like I like going home and practice during lunch periods, all that stuff. I was like so ready. And then I took one lesson with this like professional clarinet teacher in New York City, and she had, you know, all the 3 Juilliard degrees, all this stuff. And she kind of like just was like, I'm sorry, honey, you're like way too late to be like pursuing it this hard.
Oh,
I got so many problems with all of that.
I know, yeah. I know.
Play the clarinet whenever you want.
Yeah, and you know, I'm young and impressionable, and I'm like, well, yeah, you know. So I still stayed with music, I thought, and I talked to my dad about it. My mom was like, pursue whatever you want. My dad was like, don't you ever pursue music. So then I was kind of like confused. And so I just kept it in my life. I thought it was like a really good, like it grounded me a lot throughout, you know, the emotional turmoil of adolescence. But then I got to college, and I was always interested in psychology, a lot of mental illness in my family, and I started taking some like general science classes, and I just found that like the process of like learning to play clarinet and putting together like how to get from A to B in a piece of sheet music was very similar to like how to get from A to B in a molecular equation. So I was like, I started to kind of see the connections and the practice and the mathematical aspects of like science and how it connects to music, and it I don't know, it just eventually clicked. And I don't know, and being able to kind of contribute to like academia as a profession is pretty rewarding, I would say.
It sounds like you like patterns is really what that is, right?
I mean, there's that philosophy that all science is patterns, but yeah. I enjoy patterns, and I think things that pay off, maybe it's more selfish of a pursuit, but like in science you run an experiment, you get data, it like happens. In music,
you know, pretty soon whether it works or not. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's kind of the same with songwriting or lyric writing or harmonies or things like that. So I don't know. People nowadays are seeing more of the connections between art and science. But I don't know. It's like it's pretty theoretically tied to.
So you guys met. You wanted to start a band, but it just wasn't in the cards, just in terms of life and scheduling and all that.
Yeah, exactly. I think I was also, like, I think I also started teaching around the same time we met up. So it was like Juliet was deep in school and I was deep in teaching. So we just couldn't make it work.
No, yeah.
Yeah. But then some time went by and you were able to get together again to write music together. How did you Marcy, you were the one who reached out to Juliet originally to write a song together. What was the impetus for you to do that?
I'm trying to remember. I think I just okay, I think it was Doja Cat and Tia and Doja Cat and Rico Nasty put out this fire collab called Tia Tamara, and I was like, I want to do a collab so badly. So I just like sat and thought through like all of the friends that I liked their music and that I wanted to work with, and Juliet came up, and so I thought I'd ask.
So flat.
Yeah.
And what did you think when she asked you, Juliet?
I was so excited. I was like, yeah, we've been building up for this for like a year now. And I feel like we did on and off, on and off have been liking each other's music and sharing each other's stuff to like our friends. And I don't know, it was finally a moment to come together. I was really excited.
So you got together, you wrote kind of what would be the rough structure of the tune. And then what was the original plan for it?
We were like thinking of combining our bands. And doing, I think we threw around the idea of doing like one instrumental track and then having each of us take the lead for two different versions in that way, because we're both such strong singers that we were like, at least I was like, I want to sing this whole thing mm-hmm. by myself. So, you know, I was like, I want to claim this song and I want to sing it all. So we were originally thinking of like letting each other have the spotlight in that way. And then when COVID hit, we were just like, we have to adapt, and mm-hmm. yeah, we figured it out.
So when you realized that you guys couldn't make the mega band out of all the bands, how many people are in your band, Julia? There's like four or five of you, right?
Yeah, we're a five piece.
Yeah. And Marcelyn, there's three of you?
There's three of us. Yeah.
Yeah.
But Travis plays like every instrument. So it sounds like there's 20 of us.
Yeah. But when you realize okay, well, we can't do the original thing that we wanted to do. But then you kind of run into the difficulty where it's just like, but how are we going to even record this? Because not only can you guys can like everyone not get together, but like even like two or three of you can't even get together. Like it's still not that's not advisable. So how did you guys go forward from that?
My band actually kind of did a test run of recording songs during this quarantine phase. So we released a song called Storm, and our drummer, Jacob, has a MIDI drum kit, so he was able to send those files to Matt, and then everybody else uses Logic, so it's kind of really easy that we can just, you know, plug in our instruments and record and just send the projects to Matt, and he can import whatever he needs. So in that way, the only thing that's kind of taken, it's not even taken a hit, but has like been an interesting engineering like problem is the drums. And no, it's just been, it's been a lot of coordination too, though, because it's like, it's the structures. We would get together every Wednesday. We would have recording days as groups and we would bang out this stuff like really quickly. So now the boundaries and the schedules it's been harder to keep up with.
And you don't have that immediacy too of everyone just being in the room together, which is so key to.
As like if there's something wrong with the timing or like the anything in any of the tracks, it's like, okay, first I have to hear it in the context of the like pieces, and then I got to send it back to like the guitarist and, you know, figure it out again. And
it's a lot more steps. And Bad Sleeper, you guys do some pretty intricate, pretty proggy type stuff right there. There's a lot of changes and movements and time changes and things like that. So mm-hmm. I imagine like accuracy and precision, while it's important in all music, is like super important for you guys.
Yes. Yeah. We spend a lot of time too when we were in rehearsals, like that was, we focused a lot on that. We would have clicks going on all the time. Yeah. I miss those days.
They'll be back.
Yeah.
Someday, I'm sure.
What about you, Marcelyn?
Well, I sent just a rough acoustic version of the song to Travis and Mike, my bandmates, and Travis, came back with this, like, fully arranged, mixed version of the song, and it was just so cool. So we ran with it. We tweaked a few things. It originally had this very intense guitar solo, and we decided to swap that out for a synth. Oh, yeah. We just, the synth felt more authentic, so we swapped it out. And we just, we all recorded remotely, so I have my little studio in my parents' spare bedroom, and that's where I recorded from, and Travis has a small studio set up in his house, fortunately, so he was able to get a pretty good sound on all the other instruments, and I think Mike has a similar setup to me in his apartment. So it's really, it felt very easy to put together just because, you know, we all have access to the equipment we need so freely. So, yeah.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah. Yeah. A lot of things now are possible now that would not have been many years ago, just in terms of people being able to work together. And yeah, the speed is different. And like, it seems like there's more steps in it. Like, mm-hmm. just, you know, there's a lot of sending back and forth and like, hey, can you change this one little thing? Can you tweak this one little thing? But then when you think about it in the end, you're just like, well, however many steps it takes, this would have been just not even possible at at some point. So, you know. I often think that too when I try not to get too frustrated with like the back and forth of collaborating digitally, where you're just like, hey, this is amazing, we can even do this at all.
Yeah, my voice teacher has been doing something similar. It's just kind of reminded me of it, that we're trying to find a program where we can rehearse together online. Because like with every video chatting thing, there's such a horrible lag. So it's like every area of music has had to evolve in different ways. And it's really interesting to see from like what the classical world is doing versus what the, you know, more DIY world is doing. And it's pretty much the same thing, you know,
right.
Like we think we're so different and separate, but you know, music is music.
Yeah. Yeah. In the end, everyone's using like some sort of USB or whatever interface,
yeah.
and the net. Did you and your voice teacher find a solution to that? To be,
yeah, is
able
there like
to
a room you
like
can hang out, like a virtual room?
So he found a couple of programs, and one, let me look at it. One is called Internet MIDI, and if one person has a MIDI plugged in and so does the other person, one person on one end can play the MIDI and that sound will come back through the other person's MIDI.
With like very little lag, like you can almost work simultaneously.
That's cool.
Yes. Yeah. It's there's a very minimal lag. I haven't tried that one yet, but I hear it's very good. And we have been using SoundJack. And you can play with the settings and get like different levels of latency and stuff, but it's we did a couple test runs of things and he accompanied me on a track. It was, I mean, on a song, and it was totally fine. It was,
wow.
Yeah, it's really cool. It's not the same, but it's like a huge improvement from what we were doing when everything got canceled in the spring.
Yeah, I've found it difficult to find something that's able to like have people collaborate together like in real time. Even like the Audio Movers programs and stuff like that, they're good. They really are, but like they're more for collaborating like on mixes and like solo sessions and things like that, and less about like, hey, I want two people to be able to just like play, you know, play guitar together or something like that. That's difficult. Have you guys come up with anything, Juliet, or are you guys still just, I guess with the MIDI and the drums and everything, it's a lot easier to sync everything up.
Yeah, so that's been like I think Matt and Jacob, our drummer, have been like working really hard on how to get good, like how to get MIDI in time, how to like manipulate MIDI to make it sound real. What can we like? How do we play with it? And yeah, so I really agree with Marcelyn in that it kind of has been easier in that way. Kind of getting everything together at least after the back and forths, it's like everything is still possible. The one thing was interesting that we tried the other day while we were finishing up the empty room mix. Matt Zoom called me And was able to share his screen with me so he could show me where he was in the track, and he would play each section, and it sounded pretty good. And this was just for, like, me giving him vocal notes or things that I hear that are off. And what was interesting, though, is that Zoom kind of selectively picks what it wants to hear, like, first within the track. So, like, sometimes I'd really only hear the crash and the drums versus, like, the vocals that I was trying to, like, comment on. But other than that, it's just back and forth sending. We haven't found a cool MIDI input-output solution or things like that.
And a lot of us, too, who are, like, weren't necessarily, like, hardcore engineers. Like, everyone's kind of had to... You're essentially a production company of one now, like, in your space. It's not... You have to know how to use it all. And people who are, like, trying to do live streams and things like that,
yeah.
You have to kind of... You got to be on the ball, like, video-wise as well, which, like, I know for many of us is an aspect that we've never thought we would have to master.
Yeah, what's interesting is, like, Matt actually has been, like, I've been diving into video production just because I know this is coming up, and also we've been looking into, like, kind of the marketing side of music and, like, what, how do you use a Facebook ad and what are the pros and cons, and, like, how can I, if, you know, if I can't go out and play shows in person, how can I get my audience out there, you know, online, things like that, and just weighing the pros and cons to those things. Are playlists important? Are things, like, you know, there's a lot to think about there too.
We all got to figure it all out now. As if before in the DIY world, we didn't already have to figure everything out.
Yeah.
Like now,
it's a,
like,
whole new game now. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I remember sitting there around April just being like, I thought what you had to do beforehand was, like, was way too much. And, like, now you're just like, nah, like, literally everything out of your house. All these pieces of, like, gaming software and all that that, like, none of us really got into if you weren't part of that scene. And then, like OBS, like, once I figured that out, I go, where did this come from? And someone's just like, yeah, Twitch streamers have been using it for years. And then I was just like, what's a Twitch stream?
I have to figure out how to use that. But every time I sit down and look at it, I'm just like, no, no.
It's both incredibly user-friendly and incredibly frustrating at the same time.
Yes, that's exactly how I found it. Okay, I'm glad I'm not alone.
As you guys were working on the songs separately, like in your own bands, in your own world, were you sharing it with each other beforehand, or did you want to kind of, like, wait for this big reveal?
We shared, like, rough versions with each other, but I think the final products were actually... I don't know. It felt like a big reveal. It was like when I heard your vocal track, I was like, oh, yeah. It was like I was hearing it for the first time. It was cool.
Yeah. No, same goes to you. And yeah, I think I think Marcelyn kind of had their version together sooner than we did. And I sent it to my bandmates and they were like, I don't know if I should listen to this yet, just because, like, I don't know, like, how similar we want them to be, or, like, yeah.
They want to be influenced.
Yeah, exactly. I listened to theirs, their first draft. Yeah.
When it all was said and done and all the final versions were done, what was, like, something in each other's songs that you heard that you were just like, ooh, I wish I'd thought of that?
Bad Sleeper's version has some cool, like, time changes in there that are just, it just really shakes things up. I like it. And I did not think of it. So, yeah, that was cool.
Yeah, and I am a huge fan of Marcelyn. She's got a bunch of cool vocal slides in there that kind of lead into each section of the song. And, like, I don't know, and they're, like, layered with a bunch of harmonies. And, like, I'm a sucker for that stuff. So it sounds awesome. It's so powerful.
You had some really cool runs, too.
Thank you.
There was, like, the one at the very end of the bridge. I was like, that was a spicy little run. It was cool.
Thanks.
You leave it to other musicians to, like, find, like, the little things. It's just like, that was so cool. And sometimes you don't even realize that you did it.
Yeah. Also, you guys have I think you had a good balance between synths and organs. Like, the organ is such a, like, lovely touch in it.
Oh, thanks. We wanted it to be spooky.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
We wrote, like, I think the first time you and I ever hung out, it was, like, beginning of November-ish, so we had, like, Halloween on the mind. So.
Mm-hmm.
the organ too keeps it a little more organic from it just being like all synths, because synths can have a lot of air behind them sometimes. I mean, you can mix them however you want, but like an organ just kind of hits and is like this sort of like low rumbly thing that like can really sort of center a track.
Yeah, Travis mm-hmm. is very particular about like certain synth sounds like that. So I think, yeah, I don't know. He did such a good job with it. I merely made some suggestions here and there, but Travis really just like took over and produced the hell out of it. So
yeah, I can definitely say the same with Matt. He, you know, I sent them like a outline with some synth and vocals, and then he just rolled with it. And
it's got that really great guitar opening, the Bad Sleeper version. I really like the opening guitar riff. I was like, yeah. Ooh, I was like, open. I'm like, open octave chords. Yay.
Yeah. It feels very, I kind of like how we're both rock, like the roast, both the versions were like rock in their own eras almost, or like their own ways.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. Yeah. The Marcelyn's is more, almost more glammy, just with all the synth and all that. And yours is a little more, the Bad Sleeper one's a little more like straight ahead, what I imagine would be like on the radio in the late 90s or something like
that's
that.
That's cool. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think that's appropriate for our bands too. Like, yeah.
Sounds about right.
It makes sense. Yeah.
Who else is in Bad Sleeper with you, Juliet?
So we got Matt Drzezinski, engineer and rhythm guitarist. He actually swaps leads and stuff with our lead guitarist, Zach Ellie. And then we have Jacob Frank, who is our drummer, and then Luis Loza, who is our bassist. And Jacob and Luis are also in this band called Hodgepodge. I don't know if you know if this is ringing a bell. And everyone, it's kind of cool. Everyone's kind of science oriented in the band. Like Matt does computer science, Luis also does like physics, Zach does chemistry, Jacob's into psych and things like that. So it was kind of like a cool,
it's a scientist mix. Prog band.
Makes sense, right?
Yeah, no, it's great. No, you would all approach, it makes sense that the music itself is can be so technical, because you all can approach it and take it apart in a way. You're not afraid to do that, because you do that in your regular life anyway, taking apart, you know, very complex things and boiling them down. You can do that with music too.
Yeah.
What else are you guys working on right now in your respective groups, if anything at all? I know this is it's a real tough time to be working together, but we do have, some of us have time right now. I mean, not everyone is, you know, not everyone is home. Like, some people are still going out there and going back and forth to work. I mean, Julia, you work in the medical world, so I imagine there's still probably a demand for you to be available.
Yeah, I'm more on the like wet lab of like research, so I was still going in the whole time, but just definitely not as much. But now we're kind of ramping back up.
Well, Marcelyn the band just finished our newest album a couple weeks ago. Yeah, thanks. So yeah, Monstrous Existence will be out on September 25th.
Cool title.
And yeah, thank you. That was it was a quote from a video game. So Monstrous Existence, we'll probably have a music video out before then.
It's good that it's done now and you've got time to kind of figure out how to get it out to people, because it's a little different now than it used to be. You can't just go play a bunch of shows. Like, you have to kind of figure out other things, but you've got time. So that's good.
Yeah, exactly. That's what we were trying to shoot for, a nice cushion of time so we could like send it around to different people for press and whatnot. So
yeah. And what about Bad Sleeper? What are you guys working on?
Yeah, so actually before quarantine hit, we were working on a 6-song EP, but you know, we couldn't get to each other after that point. So what we're ending up doing is actually taking apart that EP and releasing them as singles. So like, we kind of have these two phases of the band. We have, like, early Bad Sleeper, which is when we were first getting together, and then, like, kind of now where we're gearing towards this more metal-y, proggy, like, heavier stuff. So we're kind of, we're working on one of our heavier songs right now called Empty Conclusions. Ironically enough, it's Empty Room, Empty Conclusions. Don't know how that happened, but, yeah, so that song is our next release coming out. I don't know, probably in like a month or two. And then we're going to start working on the EP, which was our kind of earlier Bad Sleeper stuff, where it's more, it's like, it just, more melodic based. It's more, I don't know, not as much distortion, I guess. And then,
gotcha.
Yeah. And like, so we're going to try and do like a monthly cycle going where we like, we have the song ready a month in advance. We like submit it to Spotify. We submit it to like Spotify playlists. And then like we start submitting it to blogs and things like same thing with having that block of time for like Marcelyn's album. Yeah, but we're just doing little things at a time at this point.
Well, that's so smart on both your parts right there to actually give time. So often that doesn't happen, or you don't give yourself enough time and then think, you know, because no project ever gets done at the time that you think it's going to get done. And so sometimes that'll end up eating into the time that you thought you gave yourself. And then you're running around and you're just like, why won't anyone write about us? It'd be like, because you asked them 2 weeks before your record came out.
Yeah, yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah, yeah.
It's so different now. You know, it's all about sending emails. I just sit at my computer and send emails all day. Whereas my brother was telling me when he was doing this in like the, oh gosh, I don't know, like the early 2000s, he would like send tapes to people. He worked for a radio station too, and he would get tapes all the time. Yeah, I can't even imagine doing that.
You would get a whole big, like big mailer envelopes from certain promoters, like once a week. Just that was their crop for that week, and they would send you. Mm. There'd be like 5-6 CDs in there, and you would, you know, take them out and place them one at a time in a CD player, and,
wow.
You know, and attempt and listen to them, and like try and listen to all of them too. That was I worked college radio in the late 90s into the early 2000s, and it was it was just your desk was just stacks and stacks of CDs, but it was a fun time.
Yeah, that sounds kind of great. Like, I wish that could be my day job.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Aside from music and all that, I asked this of all my guests recently is, what are you all doing to, my phrase for it is staying even. Like, ooh. What are you doing in your day-to-day just to kind of keep it going even?
Hours and hours of Animal Crossing.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I've been painting a lot, too. Just like trying to do fulfilling hobbies. I am also still working a little bit. Like I'm still teaching and I'm still, I'm in school. This semester's off, but I still have to spend the whole summer, you know, learning an opera. So
yeah.
Yeah.
Casual.
You know, it's a very difficult opera too. So it's been a busy summer. Yeah, I don't know. You just gotta keep going. Just trying to fill my time with stuff that I like.
Yeah. And how about you, Juliet? Because I know you've got to go out there and, you know.
Yeah, face
I imagine the laboratory is a controlled place where, you know, that's a place where you and your colleagues have already been like, you know, there's already all kinds of procedures and stuff in place anyway.
Yeah, so I'm very thankful
you guys
for that.
Are ready.
That's like,
yeah.
You know, we have PPE galore and like, you know, everything's cleaned and sterilized. We have autoclaves, all that stuff. So it's pretty, I feel safe going in and out. So yeah, I mean, I'm still only going in about 3 to 4 days a week. It's still not, you know, forever. And I'm also a part-time master's student, so I had some summer classes. And but actually in the meantime I've been getting into pixel art. I don't know if you like, and making sprites of people, things like that.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Like little 8-bit like Minecraft looking people and all that.
Yeah. My partner's recently gotten into using this Pico 8 simulator. I don't know if you've heard of that. But it's basically like an NES simulator on her computer, and it can only really emulate the sounds that an NES can make too. So like you have really limited notes, you have really limited instruments and like even rhythm sections. So you have to pick like quarter note, half note for like each of the like tracks. And I don't know, it's like it's more chiptune-y based music, things like
that. Well, this is great. Thank you so much for talking. Both songs are excellent. And both songs are different enough that, like, you can put them back to back. And aside from the vocals and a bit of the melody, but not even really, you guys definitely took on sort of different styles of the vocal melody.
Yeah.
I think it's interesting to hear two groups, like, play one song and see what they bring to it. And then also that you did it in more of isolation than you would have originally planned to do it in. I think just creates another interesting thing to think about when you look at a song and all the different ways that you can attack a song.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
It was great. It comes out
August 21st.
21st. Excellent. And it is called, I wrote down everything but what it was called.
Empty Room.
Empty Room. I knew that once you said it. I listened to it and everything, and I just looked down and I said, and it's called, and I looked down and I was just like, you didn't write it down.
Of course.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much, Marcelyn and Juliet, for talking.
Absolutely.
Yeah, take care. Thanks. We'll be together till the end of time. 25
Well, that's the show for this week. Thank you so much for listening. Thank you, Marcelyn. Thank you, Juliet, for talking, for being my first two people talking at me through a screen at the same time podcast experience. It was great. It was great to talk to both of them. Great to find out more about Juliet and her band, Bad Sleeper. Like I said at the top of the show, Marcelyn's been on the show before. Go to 25oclockpod.com. Find her old episode on there. The track is called Empty Room. You can get it at their respective band camps, badsleeper.bandcamp.com and marcelyn.bandcamp.com. And you can also get it everywhere that you get digital music, all the places. I won't name them. There's probably six more that I don't know about since I recorded the intro. But yeah, that's what they're doing. And what I'm going to do here, because we've talked about both songs, we've talked about the differences and the similarities and all that, is I'm just going to play them both for you. I'm going to play you the Bad Sleeper version first, and then I'm going to play the Marcelyn version. I just decided in that moment the order that they would go in. We're going to do that. So I hope you enjoy it. It's 25 o'clock. Philadelphia's longest running music podcast, I think. My name is Dan Drago. Until next time, take care of yourselves. Now enjoy Empty Room, done both ways by Bad Sleeper and by Marcelyn the band. Enjoy it. The pain.